The biggest, I think, difference for me is that as an artist or writer, the immediacy with which you have an audience with the internet, it's just so much different than, like, you know, as a poet in my younger, much younger years, before it was sort of like, before I was doing a lot of online publishing, it was much more like sort of home with like head in oven, you know, writing slowly, and now it's more of a, the audience is right there, and because of that, I've actually kind of made a distinction, which like some people will call my Twitter account poetry, but I actually don't, and I don't know why I do that, but with my poetry, I like to, I prefer to not use anything so time sensitive. Like I want something that is more eternal, because I think that's a direct reaction to so much of my life being spent online, where like in some ways things are eternal. I mean, like a search term, you know, a web page can live forever. But at the same time, the turnover is just so fast, that I think when it comes to poetry, it's like, I don't know, I want more space for like contemplation and also so maybe something that just won't be thrown away so quickly.
Yeah, that's fascinating. I mean, John, do you find that there's something ephemeral about language online that is not, that doesn't hold for?
No, I don't find it ephemeral at all, especially since the nature of the medium is such that there's a certain permanence about it. I see the time that we're in as a linguistic improvement over the way things were before, although it's hard to feel it within our short lifespans and seeing the changes happening at such a dizzying speed. And so, for example, imagine this space, say, 150 years ago. It may have been this building, for all I know. No, it wasn't this building. But this space, you can imagine probably Edgar Allan Poe was here. Let's say something was going on here that involved language. If we could go back to that time, one thing that we would find odd is how arid the linguistic culture would have seemed, because if you spoke, you were expected to speak in a high oratorical style. You were supposed to use remarks. All of us would have notes with us instead of just going blind the way we're doing it now. And if you wrote something, you were expected to write in tapeworm sentences. Henry James could have a career. And that was all, really, that there was. There was very little room for speaking in a vernacular way and having it considered artful, except for the narrow realm of maybe a certain kind of quaint vernacular performance. You might write the way a working class Irish person spoke in a book, or there might be a book of verse, but that was it. Today, we have a much richer culture because, for example, in addition to speaking in a formal way, although actually the space for that in the culture has narrowed considerably, it's considered artificial to speak too well. The fact is, with spoken word poetry, and especially rap, vernacular language used artfully now makes money and is part of the culture. You can't say that America has no poetry because America has rap. Then in the meantime, all of these things we're seeing online, as chaotic and as variegated as it can look, what that is vernacular writing occupying a space in the public square. And so now you can write the way you talk, and we can reflect all the complexities and the nuances and the jokes in the way we talk in print, and all of this is vernacular and spontaneous, and it's hot and it's messy because that's what speech has always been. But we can do that in a way that was virtually impossible in, say, 1980. So that means that we have a richer linguistic culture than we had 125 years ago. We have a richer linguistic culture than we had 20 years ago. I think it's all fantastic myself.
Yeah, just to push back a little bit though, if we, and I'm playing devil's advocate because I'm not sure I hold this opinion,
that's good.
But if we already talk the way we talk, then how is it a broadening or an expansion to now start writing the way we talk too?
Because when you're writing the way you talk, you're making it better because you can look back and fix things and you can affect things. So for example, if you write in all caps, you're not yelling. You're yelling. There's an irony in it. If you really yell in writing, the last thing you're going to do is use those rather funny capital letters. So it's artful speech written down. We couldn't do that when we were children. I love it.
So do you think that the irony, I mean, people talk about internet speak, which we know is not a monolith, but when people sort of try to describe it as one thing, they say it's tinged with irony. That's sort of its prevailing characteristic. And it's interesting to think that maybe that irony comes from the necessary gap between speech and writing. When you translate speech to the page or to the screen, there is going to be something lost and something gained, and it's not a one-to-one thing. And so maybe the irony comes in to sort of signal awareness of that sort of slight disjunction.
That's my next book. Yes. I mean, okay. The whole idea that we think of ourselves as more ironic than people in the past, we're trained to think that couldn't be true, but I'm beginning to think it is true. And the question becomes why, and a lot of it has to do with exactly that disjunction between print and speech, which we now negotiate all day long every day. It makes us a different kind of person, I'm coming to suspect. Yes, there was irony in 1925, but there was a different kind. There's something about modern language that I think bears looking into. As you can see, I started working on this about 10 minutes ago, but I can't get off of it. I'm going to be persistent.
Well, that self-consciousness, the sort of the self-awareness, we certainly see that reflected all the time in, you know, social media and other online discourse. What's interesting is that, you know, this is something John has talked about in the past too. You know, that gap that you're talking about between text and speech, and how we make up for the fact that we are, you know, having something that's like speech but in a textual form, but we're missing things, and we make up for that in various ways. And what are we missing? All the sort of non-linguistic, or what are sometimes called paralinguistic features, things that go along with language. So the things that we do in terms of our gestures, what we do with our face and our tone of voice and all the rest, that might be lost, and how can we make up for that through a little hashtag or emoji or something like that, which can, you know, help to present a certain kind of stance, an attitude. And it very often is a distancing kind of stance. It's like, I'm saying this, but now I'm gonna pull back a little. I might be a little sort of self-effacing about it. In a way, it's almost like a preemptive strike, because people can so easily ridicule you, and I'm going to do it to myself first by, you know, putting on a, you know, using a hashtag or emoji that, you know, indicates that. And so, as John was saying, I mean, there are ways that we sort of are immediately ironicizing ourselves and our speech, and it's fascinating to watch, because we do it to ourselves and then we do it to other people, and there's this kind of interchange that happens where. You know, where a particular linguistic turn of phrase, for instance, may pop up, and then seemingly almost immediately now, it can get sort of recontextualized, resignified in all these different ways, and sort of shot through with all these different voices that are giving their own stances on it. So there's, you know, can happen immediately. I mean, we see it happening, for instance, with political language. I mean, there are plenty of examples we could talk about from the campaign. It's Hillary Clinton says the word deplorables, and within hours, deplorables means something quite different from what she meant it. It's or on the other side, when Donald Trump says nasty woman or bad hombres. So there's this kind of re-signification that's happening so quickly. I mean, it's like, you know, within hours of a public figure saying something, you can get it on an ironic t-shirt. So. That, you know, that process of, you know, has been so accelerated that we come to expect it. I mean, everything is already on its surface ironic somehow, and you have to peel through those layers of irony to really understand it, if you ever do.
And it's preserved. And so in terms of history, the fact that we are actually getting in this at least relatively permanent form these new expressions that come in means that we'll be able to know how we talked in the future in a way that it's sobering how little we can now. So for example, Film Forum ran a silent film from 1920, I believe, six, about a year ago. It was about a flapper. It was called Be Yourself. And you think, well, okay, be yourself means that she's going to realize herself and be honest about herself. And you can't help thinking that's a little present for a film in 1926. Be yourself. Why do they call it that? I did some digging around, Ben. I don't know if you found this expression. Be yourself in the 20s meant, be yourself, as in get real. That's something that people said. I found it in two things. Somebody saying, be yourself. But frankly, the people who said it are dead or close to it, and it's not something that you would find in any slang dictionary. I just found it by accident because I'm strange. And the fact is that in the film, because it's silent, you're watching people talking. What were they saying? They didn't sound like Fitzgerald novels. They didn't talk in full sentences any more than most of us do. What were they saying? We don't know. They're gone. Everybody's going to know what we were saying. I find that thrilling, even if I'm not here to see it.
Okay, I want to jump on the be yourself catchphrase because something that really fascinates me about your work is that you use irony and the sort of hedging of internet language, or you have not maybe so much in your most recent book, but you have used that self-consciousness to ironically show authenticity. Like the idea that everything is behind seven veils means that you are actually more present and more real than you might otherwise be if you hadn't sort of used that system of codes. And I wonder if maybe you could take us inside how that works, or whether that was intentional, or whether that even makes sense.
I think it's just dark humor. You know, I think it's like, what do they say? Humor is suffering plus time. So there's not much time, actually. There's a lot. It's a lot faster, you know, from bad idea to tweet is a lot faster than from bad idea to mailing a letter used to be, or from bad idea to, you know, video. Bad idea to tweet is pretty fast. And I think, actually, in some ways that can make for some of the most, like, primal, immediate language, but I think, or it can make for, like, some of the best writing and some of the worst writing, you know, that songs that editorial filter. But in terms of the way irony plays with being oneself, I feel like if I make something humorous, I can get away with more to some extent. Like, I can tell more of the truth about myself. It's less scary to tell the truth about myself if there's irony. But it's interesting that we've been talking about irony as this result of sort of things shifting into a more textual basis, and then, and like, not being able to read someone's body language. Because I feel like, what are some of the things that we've had to do to convey irony now that we lack? Because often I feel like when you send a text message, you know, the irony can be lost, and so we have to be more explicit in our irony, you know, and hence emojis. Those will serve to be like, only kidding, or I've seen, like, people will put asterisks next to certain words, you know, like, there's indicators. And I found myself even LOLing too much. Like, sometimes I'll just get in, like, an LOL spiral of, like, LOL death, and, like, I'm texting with someone and just, like, everything is LOL. And, like, instead of saying yes, even things that are not funny at all, I've been crying and texted LOL, actually, just to kind of take the pressure off of having to be, like, a human being having feelings, you know, and risking saying something vulnerable. So I guess, so I don't know. I think, like, it's a question, like, maybe we do have more irony now, but, like, is our humor more stupid, or I don't know, what's a way to say it? You guys are you're the linguists.
I don't think our humor is more stupid, but I think that
obvious.
It's not only the irony, it's also just the transcriptional honesty. If you listen to most conversations, we laugh and giggle much more than we might assume. It's a social easing. It's a little, you know, they're little martinis that you stick in between every couple of sentences. For somebody who never laughs, doesn't do all of that meaningless giggling, that's an indication that they don't like you, really. It's part of being a person. If you were going to make a robot seem real, the robot would have to learn to do all of this senseless laughing that we all do. LOL is just that. It basically comes in exactly where you would go, huh? And it means that you're actually transcribing the way people actually talk. It's wonderful. We don't know how Eleanor Roosevelt talked, but we know how we talk. She went, but we never get to see it.
I also feel like there's with LOL, like if I'm texting with someone, if I'm in an internet chat with someone, let's say, a chat room, I'm never in a chat room, but let's pretend, you know.
I never really even knew what that was, but go ahead.
It was a strange place. Like, I feel like bad things happened in there.
You could tell. Yeah. Stayed out.
Dark. Yeah. Bad things happen. But I feel like LOL can kind of, I mean, the amount of LOLs that equate to even someone, I mean, laughing out loud, forget it, but like even just a huh, like I wonder how many LOLs to huhs, like what's the ratio? Because I almost feel like LOL is a way of soothing someone else too, like I'm hearing what you're saying, even if it's like I want you to go away.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. It's like a Tums pill. I don't know why I thought of that, but it's for the conversation. Yeah.
But I mean, again, it sort of takes the place of certain, ways that we sort of lubricate our conversation and make it easier. And linguists talk about sort of the phatic function, phatic, where you're talking about the function that where we're using language just to sort of open a channel, maintain the channel, let you know, I hear what you're saying, I am not
right.
And then so all of that those things that we do just naturally in terms of turn taking in a conversation that we do face to face, we find these new ways of expressing it, whether it's LOL or just a K for OK, which is generally just
the death blow. That's like
I'm told that's the angry one, right?
Well, it depends. I mean, this isn't some monolithic, kind of usage. I mean, in certain subcultures, that K could be, let's say dating, I don't know. That could be a very sort of, difficult thing to deal with. What does that K mean? When it's just, could you just pick up the stuff from the store on your way home? K. It's like, I've heard what you said. I'm not disagreeing with it. I understand. There's no problem here. You need a reaction from me. I'm providing one.
Over and out.
Over and out. Roger that.
You don't smell a little bit of, well, if I must, in that K?
Well,
in that exact situation, if I got back the K, it would be, well, why didn't you pick up the cereal?
That's a lot to read into a K, but okay.
Well, so K period, I think, would be
real.
I mean, because if you're going to bother to punctuate your text, like, you are feeling some feelings, I think.
Yeah.
Recently, I had an experience where I wasn't sure if someone was mad at me, and the last text they had sent had a period, and I was like, shit, that like it's on. But then I looked back, and every single one of their texts, even when we were in like lovely times, had been ended with a period. So it's not a nice thing to do to a person.
That sounds like a sitcom plot.
Well, I think it's also hard because it has changed so fast. I remember when I first started texting, it's, oh, how do I make sure that people know that I'm joking? Like, what emoji or what jokey things can I include? So
JK.
But now it's like, how do I let people know I'm serious? So it's like, I am mad at you. And LOL, haha, I hate you too. I'm like, no, I'm really mad at you. Like, that was terrible. So I guess maybe the solution to that is like, don't have those freighted conversations over text. But yeah, it's hard. It's a jungle.
What happened to email is a question. There was a time when one could write long emails, and it was considered normal. I would say that time, I think of yellowtail wine being fashionable. It was around when blogs were just coming out and there was no kale. And you could still, you could write emails. And somewhere around 06 or 07, you started getting very brief responses to long emails, and I learned nobody wants them anymore unless they're over a certain age. I mean, I'm 51, my sense is that people about 65 and over still don't mind. But other than that, I've learned nobody wants a long email. It seems texting replaced it, but it means you can say less. Am I getting old and feeling that way?
I think the actual correlation here is kale. So it's not texting, it's kale. Now
kale
we just have
kale.
Email has become EKL.
It was the tipping point.
Yeah.
I remember this. Ben, what about you on that? Didn't you used to write long emails?
Yeah, there's definitely been a shift, and it's fascinating to see how something like, you know, email, which seemed so cutting edge, you know, 20 years ago or whatever, now seems old fashioned, now seems quaint, now seems like something you would associate with, Sandra Bullock on the net or something, you know, that the some like old fashioned idea of what we do online.
Sleepless in Seattle.
Right. I think that's definitely, if we're looking to the future, I mean, that shift is ongoing. And certainly when people are now these days looking for more secure forms of communication that won't somehow get hacked, email seems, you know, even less of an appealing thing to as a mode of communication. But certainly texting has taken its place in many ways. But it's also I think just the sort of the short form communications that we have, whether it's text messaging or, you know, tweeting and various other things. In some ways we expect more of that kind of rapid fire, you know, call and response type of communication. And to the extent that I get emails, very often they look like that now. And so I think there are certain expectations that are changing. It's like we should be able to say what we need to say in this very concise format. Obviously there are sort of more long form explorations and things, but in terms of just sort of everyday communication, in some ways we may have sort of stripped down a lot of the bells and whistles. We're not necessarily so concerned with, you know, how do I start this email? How do I end this email? How do I address this person? We could just go straight into the message without even having a, you know, dear so-and-so or hi so-and-so or whatever, because that's just more the expectation now. We don't need to figure out a sign-off either, you know? And so obviously there are situations when you're dealing with someone that you're not necessarily comfortable with, where there might be a certain power dynamic, say between a professor and a student and things like that, where these sorts of issues become sort of more fraught in how you sort of craft this message. But for the most part, when we're dealing with people in our surroundings, people that we're familiar with, we can dispense with a lot of that. That seems to be one ongoing trend that we're witnessing.
I mean, would you relate this to sort of the onrush of information that we're all experiencing now? Like, we need a more compressed way to communicate with each other because there's just so much out there. I remember I was reading a little bit about, I think this guy was writing in the mid-90s, but he was saying that instead of sort of savoring language online, we are hunting for information sense. And so we kind of ruthlessly scan the page and we think, what can we extract from this and then move on to the next thing? And if we don't get a scent, then we're off to the next thing and you have lost our interest, goodbye forever. And so I do wonder whether this is a matter of information overload as opposed to just changing mores for no reason.
Yeah. We do have an information overload, or at least a whole lot more than there once was. I can distinctly remember, say, 1995, what I read from physical magazines and newspapers. I did not feel that there was too much. I wanted to read more than I ever could read, but there was more time to, I hate to say it, but to look up and smell the roses. Now, with the endless temptation of the devices that all four of us are going to be looking at as soon as we step off of that stage. Yes, it's harder to read a book, it's harder to read a long New Yorker article, and there's just so much that we can learn from the 100 things that we look at every day. Now, I think we can idealize the extent to which any of us were truly taking in all of that long-form literature before. So for example, yes, you would sit and read a mile-long article in The Atlantic about this, that, or the other thing. But I don't know, but how many people were really reading the whole article, and how much were we retaining of all of that? All of that may have been a sort of Victorian artifice that was hanging on. Maybe the fact that we're all now living in a village where we're communicating in short overlapping bursts all the time, and increasingly reading in that way. Maybe it's more natural, and maybe in the end we're not losing anything, is my tendency. But there's a part of me that misses that you could curl up with something not so long ago, and there was nothing to look at on your phone. You know, that wouldn't have made any sense. It's harder and harder. I will never again write a book longer than about 180 pages, because I just assume I wouldn't want to read a book longer than this. I know I can't hold their attention. And I've learned more and more lately that spoken forms get to more people than anything that's on a page, because people carry their earbuds around. It's not going to change. But it's dislocating how quickly all of this has happened, very much so.
I mean, Ben, you're a scholar of these trends, but I wonder if you have actually absorbed any of them as a writer and a columnist for the Wall Street Journal.
Well, it's funny. I mean, I tend to write in these 500 word bursts or 1,000 word bursts, just because that's kind of the format that I've inherited, and it continues to be a useful one. You can keep people's attention for that length if you're sort of writing a newspaper column length. I do find though that extending beyond that into longer form things, sometimes I do find that I've trained myself to write this particular length and get one sort of coherent message out, and then you're done, you're on to the next thing. So the way that people are consuming things, with this kind of information overload, you might pick, one article to read, or, one message, and then you're on to the next thing. I would say that in some ways that sort of informs my approach, but I've always been sort of short attention span anyway, where I want to sort of focus very intensely on one particular, say, word in the news or language issue people are talking about, and then move on to the next thing. And so, if anything, I would say yes, that with social media and everything that leads to this kind of people just focusing on one thing for a flurry of attention and then moving on to the next thing, that's probably encouraged some of my bad habits in terms of that, having that short attention span. And I'm finding I'll go back and read columns that I wrote a year ago or 2 years ago and think, oh yeah, I completely, it's already passed out of my memory. It's like, that's what we were talking about. I was actually just talking to, I used to write for the Boston Globe before I wrote for the Wall Street Journal, and I was catching up with my former editor, Amanda Katz, and we were reminiscing about 2012, when I wrote for the Boston Globe, and my most popular column by far was the one that I wrote about YOLO. And that was a big thing in 2012. And here we are 5 years later, it's YOLO. Was that really?
What is that one? My students use it. What is it?
You only live once.
Yes, that's
yes.
Right.
Yeah. Okay, see. Yeah, all right. These things have such a short shelf life very often, where just looking back on something like from 5 years ago just seems like an eternity.
YOLO. Is it still current?
By the end of 2012.
YOLO.
It was there was a Drake song that featured it, and it got this flurry of popularity in early 2012. When I wrote about it in the summer of 2012, young people were already sick of it, and anybody over the age of 20 didn't even know what it meant. So there was this weird, age divide that had happened. But then, people like Katie Couric started using it, and it was definitely dead at that point. But I feel like that whole process that happens, that kind of churn, just, happens, faster and faster now, where obviously things like slang terms always have this, what was popular last week might not be popular this week, these sort of, it just like fashion, it sort of can change very quickly, but it just feels like social media now allows that churn to happen even faster, so that you missed yesterday's meme, too bad, Or by the time you get to it, it's now layered in so many, you know, layers of irony that you have to sort of peel apart if you sort of, you know, missed this sort of ongoing development and the birth and death of a particular meme or turn of phrase.
Remember how important the hashtag seemed in, say, 2012, all those articles that people like you and me had to write or read, and how students would write papers about it? Well, now that's kind of passé.
Well, I wouldn't say passé.
It's being used, but is it as interesting as we thought it was?
I don't know. I mean, I think it perhaps had a certain peak, but these things often go in cycles, so.
I think there's also a sort of like in-group, out-group thing that gets created. Like, I remember when I first went on Twitter, I didn't know what the hashtag was. And it was weird. Like, everyone was using it, and I felt very estranged. And I was like, why is there a pound sign or, like, a waffle? Like, I kept seeing it as the waffle. Like, I kept picturing it as the waffle. And same with, like, the sideways, when you do a heart, that's, like, the less than sign, and then the three. I was like, why is everyone saying less than three? Like, I just did not understand. But sometimes there will be something like language or like a term that'll come up on Twitter, and like I feel like it's something, like I take a long time to actually Google it, like I resist Googling it, but then finally there's like a moment where it's like, you know, I have to, and it's always like the dumbest origin, you know, but it seemed so mysterious and like, you are not of the moment unless, like, the most recent one was, I think, the Dr. Phil girl. There was a girl on Dr. Phil, and she was like, what did she say, cash me outside? Cash me outside, yeah. Like, it was like.
Is that a couple weeks ago?
Yes.
I never knew what that was. I didn't have time to check it out.
It's right. For the, yeah. So, and when I saw it, I was like, this is where it came from? You know, because like people I like really like and respect are all, I'm like, oh, I really have to find out the origin story of this cash me outside. And I was like, it's a doctor, like it was very strange. So sometimes it's a little sad to peel back the layers.
What did
actually
that mean? Cash me.
Cash what? Me outside. It was like.
Do I want to know?
Like just like, come fight me outside.
Oh, so that's what
she was like singing to her mom.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right. I remember.
So, but you know, people really took to it.
Yeah. I mean, I think a similar experience I had last week was everyone was mad about pineapple pizza. Was that just me?
It was 2 weeks ago.
Okay. I'm sorry.
You were a little slow
myself
on that one.
Yeah, I saw that on Facebook. I didn't understand.
No.
Why were they angry?
I think they found it objectionable that people would put pineapple on their pizza, which seems like a strange hill to die on, but also something that was settled many, many years ago.
We are an
affluent
society.
As an acceptable thing to do.
Wow.
But you can feel kind of nice standing outside of time and saying, I have no idea why the kids are talking about pineapple pizza. I don't know what this set of letters or this acronym means. And yet I live, yet I persist, and I move on, and it's okay.
Thirsty?
That's what poetry is for me.
What's thirsty? I heard somebody the other day say thirsty, and I could tell it did not involve water. Is that newish?
Well,
horny and desperate.
I'm all thirsty. What was she talking about? I really don't know what it means.
It definitely came up in the American Dialect Society Word of the Year voting about 2 or 3 years ago. Yeah, yeah. As sort of a
new, that old?
Well,
I don't know what that means.
I'm sure it has even older, you know, precursors. But yeah, to be sort of desperate. Thank you. Sort of wanting something in an unseemly way, or just you know, seeming. It's more. It's about appearances, I would say. You know, just sort of like. You know,
does it mean horny?
Desperately horny.
Horny. Okay.
Oh. Hornily
so
desperate.
Is that what it means?
I mean, I think you can be thirsty about your career. You can be thirsty about ambition. But I think the standard use, if I may, is horny.
That would be the canonical thirsty.
The canonical thirsty.
Poor definition. These things come up so quickly. I don't know all these things.
I think we should take some questions from the audience. Maybe if, I wonder how would be the best to do this. You guys, Oh, excellent. Sure. If people just want to raise their hands and yes, sir.
I get to go first.
Oh. Okay. Sure. Shout out.
I can be loud. So I find it very interesting that we've talked about speech and language, but so much of what happens in communications now is via video and images, photographs that are overlaid with all kinds of little things that distort them in various ways. Maybe the question is, why haven't you spoken about that means of communications?
I was actually going to make a snarky comment when we were discussing like text, the replacement of email with text, and I was going to say, no more text. Like now everybody's Snapchatting.
Yeah, that's right.
You know,
and the GIFs/GIFs and the memes, etc. It's ever more pictorial. That's definitely true.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's necessarily that the pictures are going to take over, but you could see it as a dynamic synergy between all these things. I kind of like the pictorial creativity where you kind of have cave writing meets rap in a way. But that's just me trying to be accepting. I don't know.
Well, I mean, the whole development of emoji has been fascinating in that it's this, you know, these little pictographs, basically, which shouldn't, you know, on the face of it, have necessarily been as successful as they've been, because you just, you know, started with a very limited set. Of course, the Unicode Consortium keeps expanding and adding new ones. But once that became available to people on their iPhones, especially on their virtual keyboards, it became sort of a new tool in their arsenal. And so, you know, you can see this kind of you can see this efflorescence of it where even though, you know, it doesn't seem like it should be something that could really develop organically, again, because there is some consortium out there that is actually deciding which little pictures you're allowed to use, and not to mention all of the difficulties where you don't even know if the emoji that you're using will appear the same on the device that it's being received on, means that it's sort of fraught with all these sort of ambiguities and so forth. And yet it's been fascinating just to see just how successful it's been. Certainly in the future, there are going to be more of these sort of, you know, combinations of text and picture and voice in some combination, and those graphic elements where people are having fun with it. But I think the tech companies are trying to figure out how can we best exploit people's sort of impulse to express themselves graphically, pictorially. I mean, if you think also about the animated GIF, for instance. I mean, this, in some ways, that's like old online technology that keeps, you know, people keep holding on to that animated GIF because, you know, you can just plop it into, you know, whatever, you know, tweet or whatever you're, and it almost at this point, I mean, has this kind of like low tech appeal to it. It can be something kind of grainy, and it's just, you know, but it adds an extra element that takes text and, you know, moves it somewhere else, or again can be a kind of a meta commentary on what you're talking about, a reaction. You're sort of providing your own reaction. And so that's what I see all of that happening. But, and we haven't, yeah, I mean, we haven't talked, we've been focusing mostly just on the sort of the textual side of it. There's this more graphic element. And then, you know, the combination with voice. I mean, if we're talking about the things that that are really going to be dominating in the future, it's going to be much more about sort of voice technology and how we use that. And now we're, you know, as obviously anyone who's interacted with Alexa or Siri or Cortana or, you know, one of these digital assistants, you know, that's where the tech companies are focusing all of their work on, like, natural language processing and things like that, where we'll look back on these days. It's like, you know, oh, you know, they were using, they were texting. That just seems so old-fashioned when, you know, sort of voice and picture maybe the primary modes in the future.
Yeah. She has a question. I want to ask after me. So I've been a proponent of voice user interfaces or previously, and I designed
you get into the sort of things that you're talking about, which are very interesting in themselves, a linguist would say that there's a stretching of the very essence of what you might consider a language to be. The three primary elements of what, for example, human language is would be shared attention. Without shared attention, there's no language. A capacity for associating arbitrary symbols with concepts, and then sharing of ideas. If you're not focusing shared attention upon using arbitrary symbols to share ideas, then that's a different kind of language than what there was. And so I think we might even need a new word for what was going on with the bits and the bytes and the mistakes that they're making or the networks that they're coming up with. That's linguist to me, and I'm used to that particular blob as applying to what I call language. Maybe I could extend myself into thinking of language as something else. You know what I mean?
Well, like, okay, so first thing, there's the three things that,
right.
That, okay, so the first is shared attention.
Right, you have to
so code, right, like code, right. Which they call languages, there's Python, there's HTML, there's like a gazillion different languages. It's creating something which I guess is a sort of, its manifestation is something that which we share, multiple people focus on, but it's like the language itself, the words itself aren't what we're focusing on. It's like the mirage or the illusion or the what the language creates. Like anything we look at online is comprised of that language, but it's just
right.
we're not looking at the code itself. We're not seeing it. So it's kind of, it's interesting. It's like a more covert language underlying everything that we're looking at online.
So the code is allowing language. But
the code is a language. Right.
But the code, from what you're saying, is the code itself a language under this definition? That's a genuine question.
I think the code is a language.
Okay.
I think the code is a language. Yeah, okay. To me it is, because it's creating spaces where there can be shared attention. And what were the other two?
Shared attention, arbitrary symbols, and then exchanging ideas.
Right, and which is definitely.
Whatever you're going to do with the ideas is a different subject, but exchanging ideas. Yeah. Okay.
And also it's a code, it's a language amongst coders too, so that things can have a uniformity, like in the way that you know, there's a signifier of something. Like when I say apple, point to an apple, it means apple to me, it means apple to you. I think that's why there's also a language amongst coders so that they can identify.
So those are languages, that kind of coding.
Yes.
I think the audience member might mean something else,
more
broader.
If I could pick up on that, just to, you know, to take Watson as an example of the promise that we are often sold nowadays with artificial intelligence as being a way that computers are now supposedly having a kind of a comprehension of language. And the way that if you watch commercials that seem to be endlessly on these days about Watson, having these seemingly human interactions with Serena Williams or whoever, you know, in a way, it's constantly irritating to me to see the way that, you know, because we have certain preconceptions of the way that, whether it's HAL in 2001 or other science fiction depictions of artificial intelligence, whether it's in the movie Her, for instance, and what our expectations are. And what is actually being delivered, I would say that Watson is a very, you know, very useful for various things. It was built as this kind of, to master this kind of question answering task. And on Jeopardy, that's exactly what you need. If you have a, you know, big enough sort of database of information and you can extract information, you can do that question answering task very well. And there are all sorts of other applications we might be able to use that for, helping doctors diagnose cancer or whatever they want to do with it. Right, that's why I brought up that example. But the expression of Watson as this sort of, you know, sentient creature is I think playing into our preconceptions of what, you know, what we think you know, an artificial intelligence should be like. It's fascinating to see what's happening these days, for instance, with chatbots, for instance, where, you know, there are lots of very interesting developments that are going on with, you know, providing certain services, very sort of limited roles like Watson that can be played, certain tasks that can be done by talking to, you know, talking to a machine, basically. And actually, sometimes in some of these, you know, applications of AI like chatbot, what you're actually getting is human-assisted AI, so that it's a machine that's programmed to sound like a human, but it might be getting some help from a human who is sort of behind the scenes and helping out. So it's a human acting like a machine, acting like a human. You get into these very, very odd things. But I think that what we see in terms of developments of that in the future too is that we're reaching a point where with chatbots and things like that, which might in some cases, you know, pass the Turing test, seem like you're interacting with a human on the other end, but not quite. And that not quite leads us to a situation, you know, we talk about the uncanny valley. It's like if it's just slightly off, it can be very disconcerting, maybe even horrifying, if you're having an interaction with something that you assume is a human at the other end, and then you realize it's not. And in some ways, I prefer a kind of more artificiality to my interactions with a digital assistant or anything like that, so that we can sort of maintain that divide and, you know, we don't have to worry about that uncanny valley problem.
I mean, who among us has not been engaged in conversation and then suddenly realized that the person you thought you were talking to is not human? And so actually, can we...
In real life.
Yes. You in the back. Yeah. Into the text that you're seeing or the images that you're seeing.
Extended argument, long arc argument, is not natural. That is not what humans are hardwired for. We're hardwired to have choppy conversation about one thing at a time, and to make a case with seven bullet points and various moreovers and howevers, that's something that's largely only possible when there's writing. And writing didn't come along in humanity until, if humanity had only existed for 24 hours, until after 11 o'clock p.m. So the natural thing is not, frankly, to dig deep in the way that you're saying. What human people do, human people as opposed to other people, is they chat at one another. And to the extent that you go deep, it would happen very gradually. And it wouldn't be about many things. I don't mean that human beings aren't intelligent, but the long argument is a ladderly artifice. That is threatened, I think, in our modern culture, because we're more and more oral, and we're taking in writing in smaller bits. Now, you can idealize how many people were really taking in long-form arguments in 1906, but you get the feeling it's going to be many fewer in 2026 because of the nature of the technology and how hard it is to pay attention to anything for very long. The only way I think we can assuage ourselves is that it's not as if human beings weren't that way before. There was maybe a brief shining moment when the long arc argument had a certain primacy. You could call it, I hate to say, education, but it's going to be harder and harder to sustain attention upon this digging deep that you're talking about. I'm not sure what to do about that.
Well, we've managed not to talk too much about politics, but it just feels like the transition from the Obama era to the Trump era is, it certainly feels like there's been a kind of a shift in what is prized discursively, and the fact that Trump readily acknowledges, you know, he owes his presidency to Twitter. He said, you know, something to that extent. The fact that he's able to package these little, you know, bombs that he can put out into the world 140 characters at a time, which have this ridiculously outsized importance, so that we're still talking about a tweet that, you know, from a few weeks ago about, you know, wiretapping and making jokes about him misspelling tap or whatever, you know, just the way that one single message like that can have this kind of outsized importance, and he has absolutely no interest whatsoever in any, you know, long rumination on a particular topic. He has a very short attention span. And so with that now as a kind of a political model for our discourse, that in some ways reflects the changes that have been going on in terms of these sort of more, you know, just bursts of communication rather than, you know, a thoughtful rumination on a particular policy topic and that sort of thing. I mean, it does give you pause to think, are we on the cusp of more serious change, or is this just something, because we're so caught up in the moment, this sort of political moment, we may be sort of giving it perhaps more significance than it deserves?
No, I think we're stuck with it for good. If Richard Nixon could have sent out tweets in 1960, he would have won. It's really a matter of what the technology allows. And Trump happened to come along at a time when he could do that. And when you could see him online speaking with his one sentence thoughts and with his savory ways of putting things, little Marco, believe me, all of that appealed not to a uniquely insensate electorate. It was ordinary. That's the way people have always been. But there was a time when you would never hear a presidential candidate speaking that way. The smoke-filled room tended to filter people like that out. And so it seemed as if things had improved. But really, all it was going to take was the invention of something like Twitter for someone like Trump, who's not interested in oratory. I don't find him extremely inarticulate. He's normal. But for someone like that, he doesn't even have to try. And yeah, he can become president. We will see more of that. It's going to be a very interesting 50 years.
But if I understand your concern just really quickly, it's not even just that he is not engaging in long ideas, but you're saying that the way that we talk now sort of favors the talker over the listener, and that there is not really a way to respond. And I take issue with that. I think like it's a compelling vision, but maybe not an accurate one, and that actually we have more opportunity to talk back, to respond, to like bring more voices into the conversation than we ever have before. And so that might be another reason for hope. Just, you know, yes, we tweet into the abyss, but then the abyss tweets back. And if you ever check your mentions after you've published a piece about Trump, for instance, hypothetically, you will see that the void is tweeting very loudly. So I do think that actually we haven't become less interested in dialogue. Actually, dialogue seems to be elevated in a way that it didn't used to be in the era of smoke-filled rooms, and that's something that at least encourages me. Yes.
So one of the things that you've spoken about a lot is this lack of an attention span. And I'm not sure if this is like a global phenomenon or it's just like, you know, the people that I know. But podcasts seem to be something that doesn't follow that trend because they're often longer. I don't know if people are actually listening to these 1 hour podcasts, but they seem very popular.
Go ahead, John.
Very quickly, it's that usually in my experience, they're not an hour. They're relatively short. And listening through the ear takes less concentration than taking something in through the eye, especially for most people. And my intuition is that most people listen to podcasts while doing something else. They're going to work or they're doing the laundry. And so I think of it as demanding less of the attention span for most listeners than reading a book. To be perfectly honest, I do a podcast, but I don't listen to them because I'm kind of a readaholic, and so I don't know. But from the feedback that I get from my listeners, all three or four, I get the feeling that
it's a very good podcast.
Thank you. They are listening in a way that takes less strenuous effort than curling up with nonfiction pages. Ben, what do you?
Yeah, the beauty of podcasts is I think there are so many different kinds now, and so that part of the appeal is you can find your niche just like so much in kind of online culture, whatever you're interested in, you're going to find other people who are interested. If you want to hear, you know, stand-up comics talk about their troubled upbringing or something like that, then you can hear plenty of that.
Is there a podcast for that?
Several.
I'll be
10.
Every stand-up comic has one. Or if you want to learn about something interesting about language, then you can listen to a half hour or so about that. I think it is true that it helps that it's something that you can consume while commuting or doing something else. And so that allows it to sort of override our short attention spans. But I think it also shows, especially in ones that are sort of set up more as a kind of a conversation, you know, we still have that, you know, real desire for insights that you can only get after, you know, really sort of feeling comfortable with another person and sort of digging deep. And so, yeah, I mean, I would say that goes against whatever trend we might be talking about in terms of sort of the superficiality of discourse. I think that there still is very much, people do want to sort of find out things in more depth and more detail, get caught up in a story, get caught up in, you know, the details of an interesting person's life, or get caught up in just the details of some interesting linguistic issue, just as an example.
Random example, yeah.
So, that's a good sign, but I think, yeah, it is easier to do that through the ear these days than devoting the time to read a long piece in the New Yorker or something like that, because it can accompany other activities and it can just sort of seep into your consciousness as you're going about your day.
Yeah. I think we have time for one more question. You look so eager in the glasses.
Yeah, so one thing that I just picked up on that Ben said a couple Trump's, you know, famous insertion of this.
Emoji is a Japanese word, but okay.
Touché.
Point taken. And I would just say that a lot of what's happening that's very exciting these days in the field of natural language processing has to do with automatic translation, the strides that have been made in the sort of more statistical methods that have allowed things like Google Translate to get pretty darn good in a lot of different languages, beyond the expectations of a lot of people who thought that it'd always be limited to just sort of figuring out the gist of something in another language. What also interests me when we're talking about sort of crossing that linguistic divide, translanguaging as some people call it, is that sometimes technology can certainly facilitate that. In, you know, automated translation is a great example of that. But it's interesting too how sometimes it throws up barriers. And you know, one thing I was hearing about from Michelle McSweeney, who's now a research fellow at Columbia.
You will hear her name, yeah.
Now, she's looked at texting among bilingual Spanish-English speakers in New York. And what's fascinating about that is that texting does not really encourage what bilingual speakers would normally be doing, code switching, switching very easily back and forth between Spanish and English. That kind of translanguaging that people do on the fly all the time if they are bilingual speakers or multilingual speakers becomes more difficult, currently at least, with texting because you are using a particular dictionary or word list that's associated with whatever messaging app or device you're using will use a particular dictionary for one language, a monolingual dictionary. So all of the autocomplete and auto-suggest and so forth that we are used to only works in that kind of monolingual environment, and then you have to switch to another, you know, consciously switch from English to Spanish or else just disable that entirely. And so bilingual speakers from this study are actually not doing as much code switching by far that they would just in their regular speech. And so that's an interesting way that because of the way the technology is created, not really taking into account bilingual or multilingual speakers as their use cases, it's something that I think that will be continue to be a challenge as the world becomes sort of more globalized and multilingual. In order to accommodate that kind of linguistic diversity in a serious way, when too often I think our technology is made by people who have this kind of monolingual American English view of things. We can see that too, obviously, with digital assistants having trouble with even just other accents, you know, other dialectal variation in English, let alone dealing with other languages.
You know, I would add to that that modern technology makes it easier than it's ever been to learn a foreign language. I mean, there was a time when you had to use books and records and cassettes in your house.
When I left my house, my 10-year-old son was learning French on Duolingo just for the heck of it. So, yeah.
See, that couldn't be, you know, 10, 15 years ago. But I'm going to say the wrong thing, but it's not the wrong thing if you just hear me out. On the one hand, we in this room can say, now we can learn Mandarin. And you can. I'm trying to teach myself, and I've got it, you know, all sorts of stuff in my phone. But, you know, the truth is, no matter how much you listen to it, if you're over about the age of 13 and you're an English speaker, Mandarin is hard. And even if you do manage to be able to say anything other than hello and the book is read, then you have to learn to read it. And learning to read it is impossible. So, on the other hand, given that there is a universal language in this world, and it's not fair, but we're using it. It's English. English took it. That's not going to change. It's not going to be Mandarin, even if more people speak Mandarin than English. The language that everybody uses is going to be English. It's easier. Now, with this technology, it'll be easier for people to have access to that language who need it. And I think that's a good thing, too. It's not that I think that English is a mighty, wonderful tongue that has, you know, bestridden the world because it was better than the others. But, you know, here we are. And so if somebody is a rural third worlder and English would help them to make a living, now they can learn it on their phone instead of having to buy DVDs of movies and watch them over and over again in their house, etc. I think that's a great thing. The world needs a universal language. It kind of has one. And with this technology, everybody will have more access to it. And we can all teach ourselves Danish. But more to the point, more people will learn Esperanto, except it's English.
Great. Thank you so much for coming, everyone. This is great. Thank you, guys.
It's really a matter of what the technology allows. And Trump happened to come along at a time when he could do that. And when you could see him online speaking with his one sentence thoughts and with his savory ways of putting things, little Marco, believe me, all of that appealed not to a uniquely insensate electorate. It was ordinary. That's the way people have always been. But there was a time when you would never hear a presidential candidate speaking that way. The smoke-filled room tended to filter people like that out. And so it seemed as if things had improved. But really all it was going to take was the invention of something like Twitter for someone like Trump, who's not interested in oratory. I don't find him extremely inarticulate. He's normal. But for someone like that, he doesn't even have to try. And yeah, he can become president. We will see more of that. It's going to be a very interesting 50 years.
Yeah. I mean, but if I understand your concern just really quickly, it's not even just that he is not engaging in long ideas, but you're saying that the way that we talk now sort of favors the talker over the listener, and that there is not really a way to respond. And I take issue with that. I think like it's a compelling vision, but maybe not an accurate one, and that actually we have more opportunity to talk back, to respond, to like bring more voices into the conversation than we ever have before. And so that might be another reason for hope. Just, you know, yes, we tweet into the abyss, but then the abyss tweets back. And if you ever check your mentions after you've published a piece about Trump, for instance, hypothetically, you will see that the void is tweeting very loudly. So I do think that actually we haven't become less interested in dialogue. Actually, dialogue seems to be elevated in a way that it didn't used to be in the era of smoke-filled rooms. And that's something that at least encourages me.
So one of the things that you've spoken about a lot is this lack of an attention span. And I'm not sure if this is like a global phenomenon or it's just like the people that I know. But podcasts seem to be something that doesn't follow that trend because they're often longer. I don't know if people are actually listening to these 1 hour podcasts, but they seem very popular.
Go ahead, John.
Very quickly, it's that usually, in my experience, they're not an hour. They're relatively short. And listening through the ear takes less concentration than taking something in through the eye, especially for most people. And my intuition is that most people listen to podcasts while doing something else. They're going to work or they're doing the laundry. And so I think of it as demanding less of the attention span for most listeners than reading a book. To be perfectly honest, I do a podcast, but I don't listen to them because I'm kind of a readaholic, and so I don't know. But from the feedback that I get from my listeners, all 3 or 4, I get the feeling that
it's a very good podcast.
Thank you. They are listening in a way that takes less strenuous effort than curling up with nonfiction pages. Ben, what do you...
Yeah, the beauty of podcasts is I think there are so many different kinds now, and so that part of the appeal is you can find your niche just like so much in kind of online culture, whatever you're interested in, you're going to find other people who are interested. if you want to hear, you know, stand-up comics talk about their troubled upbringing or something like that, then you can hear plenty of that.
Is there a podcast for that?
Several.
I'll be
10.
Every stand-up comic has one. But or if you want to learn about something interesting about language, then you can listen to a half hour or so about that. I think it is true that it helps that it's something that you can consume while commuting or doing something else. And so that allows it to sort of override our short attention spans. But I think it also shows, especially in ones that are sort of set up more as a kind of a conversation, you know, we still have, you know, we still have that, you know, real desire for insights that you can only get after, you know, really sort of feeling comfortable with another person and sort of digging deep. And so, yeah, I mean, I would say that goes against whatever trend we might be talking about in terms of sort of the superficiality of discourse. I think that that there still is very much, people do want to sort of find out things in more depth and more detail, get caught up in a story, get caught up in, you know, the details of an interesting person's life, or get caught up in just the details of some interesting linguistic issue, just as an example.
Random example, yeah.
So that's a good sign, but I think, yeah, it is easier to do that through the ear these days than devoting the time to read a long piece in The New Yorker or something like that, because it can accompany other activities and it can just sort of seep into your consciousness as you're going about your day.
Yeah. I think we have time for one more question. You look so eager in the glasses.
Yeah, so one thing that I just picked up on that Ben said a couple minutes ago was about Trump and nativism and one might say linguistic nationalism. We talked about sort of nonverbal language, also about the language of technology, but one thing that we haven't really addressed is non-English language, non-American language, as it were. Right now we're exposed to so many different languages out there in the world. This is New York City.
Emoji is a Japanese word, but okay.
And so I'm just sort of fascinated by how sort of American-centric and English-centric this conversation was when language was so much broader. Obviously, the internet is very English-centric in and of itself. But I'm just curious to hear your take on the opportunities to reach out into other languages rather than just sort of English.
Touché.
Point taken. And I would just say that a lot of what's happening that's very exciting these days in the field of natural language processing has to do with automatic translation, the strides that have been made in the sort of more statistical methods that have allowed things like Google Translate to get pretty darn good in a lot of different languages, beyond the expectations of a lot of people who thought that it'd always be limited to just sort of figuring out the gist of something in another language. What also interests me when we're talking about sort of crossing that linguistic divide, translanguaging, as some people call it, is that sometimes technology can certainly facilitate that. And, you know, automated translation is a great example of that. But it's interesting, too, how sometimes it throws up barriers. And, you know, one thing I was hearing about from Michelle McSweeney, who's now a research fellow at Columbia.
You will hear her name, yeah. Yes.
Now, she's looked at texting among bilingual Spanish-English speakers in New York. And what's fascinating about that is that texting does not really encourage what bilingual speakers would normally be doing, code switching very easily back and forth between Spanish and English. That kind of translanguaging that people do on the fly all the time if they are bilingual speakers or multilingual speakers becomes more difficult, currently at least, with texting because you are using a particular dictionary or word list that's associated with whatever messaging app or device you're using will use a particular dictionary for one language, a monolingual dictionary. So all of the autocomplete and auto-suggest and so forth that we are used to only works in that kind of monolingual environment, and then you have to switch to another, you know, consciously switch from English to Spanish, or else just disable that entirely. And so bilingual speakers from this study are actually not doing as much code switching by far that they would just in their regular speech. And so that's an interesting way that because of the way the technology is created, not really taking into account bilingual or multilingual speakers as their use cases. It's something that I think that will be continue to be a challenge as the world becomes sort of more globalized and multilingual in order to accommodate the kind of that kind of linguistic diversity in a serious way, when too often I think our technology is made by people who have this kind of monolingual American English view of things. We can see that too obviously with digital assistants having trouble with even just other accents, you know, other dialectal variation in English, let alone dealing with other languages.
You know, I would add to that that modern technology makes it easier than it's ever been to learn a foreign language. I mean, there was a time when you had to use books and records and cassettes in your house.
When I left my house, my 10-year-old son was learning French on Duolingo just for the heck of it. So, yeah.
See, that couldn't be, you know, 10, 15 years ago. But I'm going to say the wrong thing, but it's not the wrong thing if you just hear me out. On the one hand, we in this room can say now we can learn Mandarin. And you can. I'm trying to teach myself, and I've got it, you know, all sorts of stuff in my phone. But you know, the truth is, no matter how much you listen to it, if you're over about the age of 13 and you're an English speaker, Mandarin is hard. And even if you do manage to be able to say anything other than hello and the book is read, then you have to learn to read it. And learning to read it is impossible. So, on the other hand, given that there is a universal language in this world, and it's not fair, but we're using it. It's English. English took it. That's not going to change. It's not going to be Mandarin, even if more people speak Mandarin than English. The language that everybody uses is going to be English. It's easier. Now, with this technology, it'll be easier for people to have access to that language who need it. And I think that's a good thing, too. It's not that I think that English is a mighty, wonderful tongue that has, you know, bestridden the world because it was better than the others. But, you know, here we are. And so if somebody is a rural third worlder and English would help them to make a living, now they can learn it on their phone instead of having to buy DVDs of movies and watch them over and over again in their house, et cetera. I think that's a great thing. The world needs a universal language. It kind of has one. And with this technology, everybody will have more access to it. And we can all teach ourselves Danish. But more to the point, more people will learn Esperanto, except it's English.
Great. Thank you so much for coming, everyone. This is great. Thank you, guys.